Does blocking trackers and being more private make you more fingerprintable? We're going to talk about it and give our thoughts. The importance of mitigating the lack of GUI-level isolation in certain Linux distros, privacy risks of CDNs, and cell tower and other kind of like communication tracking via radios. We'll give some of our thoughts on this stuff. This all comes from our Q&A from both Patreon and xmrchat.com. Over on Patreon, you get to give back to this podcast in a recurring fashion, and we give you some perks, like you get access to the Q&A, you leave your questions, and also you get access to ad-free episodes without sponsor segments for our regular show. You can also join our Signal group. We have a private Signal group where Nate and I are active for you all, and we also include SimpleX. And of course, XMR Chat is one-off, and it's just with Monero, if you just want to ask a question and be done with it. So the highlight question this week is from old forum user on XMR Chat, and they said, "Hi guys, I'm using NextDNS with Hygezi Ultimate. I'll explain what those are soon if you haven't heard of them. Plus, they use their own list via Mulvad to block telemetry and other non-essential requests on their iOS device. Will denying these requests expose me more, making my device more fingerprintable across apps and websites?" First, to explain some stuff here. So a lot of you might know what a VPN is. It allows you to connect to a virtual private network, and they'll essentially function as your internet service provider, so to speak. So all the websites that you access will get the IP address of your VPN provider. Typically, your VPN provider has its own DNS address associated with it. However, a lot of people, myself included, really enjoy using things like NextDNS, which is essentially a custom DNS tool that lets you apply custom filters, and you can set block lists and allow lists, and you can set times where certain things are blocked. And it's also a usability thing, like you can block social media during work hours. It just gives you a lot of control. And you can also use other lists. And Hygezi is one of those lists that you can use to filter out tons of websites. It's probably the best one. It's actually the one I recommend if you're going to use NextDNS. Now, some people are wondering about if this makes you more fingerprintable. There's a lot that goes into this. And like most things in privacy, there's a lot of nuance involved. So my take on this is that short answer is in some ways, yes. Websites will be able to see, right? Like when you access a website from one VPN server, let's say there's 1,000 people connected to that same IP address at the same time as you. If you all are connecting to it with the same DNS and VPN, and you're not logged in, it's going to be really hard to distinguish users. Now, there's a million other ways to fingerprint those users anyway, because VPNs aren't inherently like anti-fingerprinting tools. So if you're using a different browser from everyone else, they can tell that you're a different user. And if you're using a different device from everyone else, they might be able to tell you're a different user. And yes, you will be showing up as having a different DNS provider as those other users. So it will immediately kind of separate you out from those different users. But you are still getting protection from your IP address. And that might be a worthy trade-off because you might get access to filters and you might have to use devices, like if you're on iOS, that there's no other way to really block those telemetry domains unless you're using custom DNS providers. Generally, my stance on this is that if you don't see any use case for these DNS providers, just stick with your VPN's DNS. It's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. And nowadays, lots of VPN providers include their own filtering out of the box. However, if you see a use case, and let's say you wanted to do something like block telemetry domains on iOS or Windows, and you're stuck on those devices for whatever reason, or you have a specific use case, maybe you want to block social media throughout the day, but not at night, and NextDNS fills that use case for you, I wouldn't let these concerns hold you back. I would just be aware of it, because ultimately, VPNs are not anti-fingerprinting tools. There's still a million ways to fingerprint VPN users, and I would still tell people that if fingerprinting is really your concern, you should be using Tor browser or Mulvad browser. So I think it's a small concern that probably doesn't impact a ton of people's use case of a VPN.
I'm going to agree that yes, you can stand out based on what you're blocking. And the reason I want to say that is because the reason everybody used to recommend Privacy Badger is because it learned as you browsed, which feels like a weird browsed. Is that past tense? Anyways, as you're browsing the internet, it would notice when certain things were following you and it would start blocking them. And EFF took that functionality away, or at least by default. I think it's still enableable, but by default, it doesn't do that anymore because they learned that it was giving everybody a unique block list, which they argued would make you fingerprintable. I think the real question here is at what point do you hit diminishing returns? I think once you start getting really aggressive with it, you have to accept that you are opening yourself up a little bit more. But at the same time, I think there's also a good argument to be made that you are blocking a lot of trackers. Same thing with JavaScript. Like, there are other ways to fingerprint you. Like, I remember seeing a proof of concept that can fingerprint you through CSS. But at the same time, you're blocking JavaScript, which from what I understand, and I'm not an expert, but from what I understand is how most of the fingerprinting occurs. So you, in one way you're standing out, but in another way you are getting a lot of defense. That's the hard part about fingerprinting is we know so little about it and how it works that it's really hard to say what's best. Like we do kind of know how it works, but we don't know what the most common practices are and things of that nature and how prolific it is. So it's really hard to say for sure at what point you're getting diminishing returns. I think
just doing this makes you unique, if that makes sense, because websites don't even have to implement a new tracking method to say, oh, like we noticed this VPN user is blocking more than another user. They can literally see the DNS you're connecting from and they can just see, oh, 999 users at this IP address all have the same DNS provider, and then this one user is using some different DNS providers. That's its own person. That's the concern there. Personally, for me, NextDNS is more than just the privacy and security offered, because you can get like similar quality to Hegesi with Mulvad's DNS filtering. Maybe, like I think Hegesi's a little bit better personally, but it's more about the customization and the flexibility and the feature set. So if there's nothing in NextDNS that interests you, then don't do this and just stick with your VPN's DNS. I think that's the easy answer. I'm actually not using NextDNS right now personally, and I've been testing out just using Mulvad's built-in lists, and I like them a lot, but I do find myself missing a lot of the functionality of NextDNS pretty frequently, so I don't know if I'm going to stick with it or not.
Will Henry stick with Mulvad DNS, or will he go back to NextDNS? Find out on the next episode of Dragon Ball Z. With that, we'll move up to David Johnson, who has three questions this week. The first one is, what is your opinion about the severity and importance of mitigating the lack of GUI-level isolation in X that most Linux BSD distros still rely on? I don't have an opinion on this, for one, because it is really technical over my head. The other reason, the end, you say, are you aware of whether this has changed in the intervening 14 years, and do you know to what degree it applies to Wayland? I don't. This all goes way over my head, but I would hope that this has been addressed in Wayland, because for those who don't know, I don't even know what X and Wayland are. They're like...
They're window management.
Okay, that's what I wanted to guess, but I wasn't sure. I know that they're very central to Linux because I listen to the Linux Experiments weekly news podcast, and he's been talking about them a lot lately. Basically, X has accumulated so much technical debt that nobody wants to deal with it anymore. It's just a nightmare for developers. So they've developed this new thing called Wayland, and it is much cleaner, and it is much more modern, and it is easier to work with, and everybody is implementing it. To my uneducated ear, it sounds like they're implementing it in a very responsible way where like X is still supported for people who need it, but Wayland is enabled by default, things like that. I would hope in that vein that Wayland is at least addressing some of the concerns that may have existed in X. But again, this goes way over my head and I'm not really qualified. This would be a great question for Nick over at the Linux Experiment, because he would probably know a lot more than I would.
Next question, what is your opinion on privacy risks of CDNs, not only from the perspective of hosting, but of a user of hosted services, in particular CDNs, which seem to be very attractive targets for mass data harvesting, like Cloudflare WAF is widely used and supposedly terminates TLS and sees plain text passwords, but they do not seem to come up as much as cell carriers or ISPs or email IM services providers in this context. Yeah, I don't have a huge amount of context on this and like the general concerns that people share. I've heard some things about Cloudflare and how people don't like the way they do it, but from what I've been able to tell, it seems a lot more like a trust issue of like, do you trust Cloudflare to be able to handle this kind of data? But again, it's not something I'm super familiar with, so I'll leave it at that.
I'm not an expert, but I do know a little bit. So first of all, you kind of hinted at this. It is a little bit of a configuration thing. I'm using Cloudflare Tunnel at home, mostly because my ISP is stupid. It's a long story. Cloudflare Tunnel has several ways you can implement it. And the easiest one that they try to push you toward is basically, yeah, letting them be a man in the middle and they will issue the TLS certs. Basically, they kind of stand at like the WAN level. Everything outside of your home, they handle, and then they kind of man in the middle and issue their own certs, and then they pass it on to whatever device in your home. There are other options to say, no, just stay out of it, provide me a tunnel, I'll handle everything myself. So it really depends on how it's been configured by the person who's using Cloudflare, like the administrator. That said, yeah, Henry's really right. It is a matter of trust. Cloudflare states in their privacy policy actually looks really good. But the question is, do you trust that? I think it says that they don't sell user data, that they only retain data for like 24 hours or something. They only retain certain data for like fraud purposes. And if you trust them, then they sound really great. But if you don't trust them, obviously, then they don't. So I think the reason we don't see it come up as much is because CDNs are so difficult to explain to everyday users. Whereas like cell phones and towers and ISPs and email and instant messenger are much easier for the average person to wrap their head around. The average person has a cell phone in their pocket. I have mine sitting right next to me on my desk right now. They know what their ISP is because they have to pay the bill every month. They know what email is. They know what messengers are. And I think CDNs are just kind of very esoteric for the average person. And so are a little bit harder to tackle. And also, like, what do you do about it? If you go to a website that's using Cloudflare, and I know this because I've used uBlock Origin in like hardcore mode or whatever. If you go to a website that's using Cloudflare and you block Cloudflare, you don't use the website. Those are your options. You either have to whitelist Cloudflare or not use the website. And in some cases, sure, that's fine. You know, I'm reading a news source, you're using Cloudflare, I'll go find another news source. In other cases, that's not an option. Like, you want to access my Mastodon server, which I'm not using Cloudflare for New Oil stuff for the record, but theoretically, you want to access my Mastodon server and I'm using Cloudflare, you can't. Those are your only options. So I think that's one reason you don't see a lot of it being talked about is you're kind of at the mercy of the web host. I don't really have any solutions. I think it's kind of a personal choice from not hosting provider, but the person hosting the website. I don't know what to call that person. There are alternatives in some cases. Like I actually saw a meme today talking about using Cloudflare to block AI scraping versus whatever that open source project is. I can't remember. You know, there's alternatives there. There are alternatives to DDoS protection, but not all of them are as effective. And so there's sometimes where you may not have a choice. Like you kind of have to use Cloudflare because they are the best at what they do or they provide that service you need. Again, Cloudflare Tunnel is perfect for what I need. But I think it's also up to them to consider, are there alternatives that can fit my needs with maybe a little bit of extra work or a little bit of extra cost that is tolerable? And I think that's a choice for them to make, unfortunately. And I think as end users, there's not really much we can do other than try to provide competing services, which I'm sure is not easy. And then the last question, you said in his book, Byron Tao wrote about hardware of modern smartphones enables one to cheaply survey a wide portion of the radio spectrum and how that supposedly is being used to outsource the grubby bits of signals intelligence collection in foreign countries. Do you know of any FOSS apps that make that accessible to ordinary cell phone users without having to learn a ton of electrical engineering and assemble and connect together dozens of expert-oriented pieces of software? There have been dedicated attempts for tower simulators and stalker trackers, but in the age of machine learning, it seems like the privacy community can benefit from a generalized app that can snip all the RF spectrum and assess if there are any abnormalities, which can then be investigated specifically. I'll be honest with you, I don't even remember that portion of the book. I don't know of any apps that do this, and I truthfully would have to go back and reread it to find that part and understand better how that information is used and how we would even begin to... I mean, if you say phones are doing it, like, I'm just going to assume that part was in the book and I'm not missing anything, then yeah, theoretically, I would think an app would be possible. At that point, I think it would be a question of access to the chip, though, because I know, for example, a lot of NFC wallet apps don't work on custom OSs because the NFC chip on Android is not available to people. I would assume that would be the first barrier here, is can we even access those radio chips to get this kind of information? But I guess my other question would be what, and I'm sure this is explained in the book. Again, I don't remember this part, but what is being accessed that would be of interest to a privacy enthusiast? Like, what could we learn from accessing this data and analyzing it? So,
yeah, I was telling Nate before we started, I remember seeing an interesting app on F-Droid and I was able to find it. It's called Tower Collector, two words, Tower Collector. It's not exactly anywhere near what they're asking for, but what this does let you do is it lets you view around you different cell towers, Wi-Fi access points, and Bluetooth beacons, and you can also contribute data. So this is not really the use case, but I think kind of at the base level, step one of what they're describing is like just being able to see towers around you, right? And just basic information. And then from there, it's like, oh, okay, well, how do we like actually start using the information, and how about we start collecting and looking for abnormalities? And then the last part of it is we add machine learning to this. And, you know, step one is just seeing the towers, and that does exist with Tower Collector. That is the most I know about what there is out there. And you can also contribute data too. So it looks like it's like an open project that you can be a part of if you really wanted to use that. All right. Well, we had some interesting questions this week from DNS, fingerprinting. And we talked about Linux BSD distros and the different, like, X versus Wayland, and whether we think that'll change, and privacy risks of CDNs, and also, interesting question, radio at machine learning radio investigations. I don't know how to summarize that last question, but definitely a fun week, and we would really love to have more people join the Q&A. So if you want to join the Q&A, join us on Patreon at patreon.com/surveillancepod, or you can just leave a one-off message. The highlight this story was sent with just some Monero, and it was one-off, and it was public on XMR chat with no personal information required. So you can check both of those out down in the description, and we'll see you this weekend for the next episode.